output of this AND gate. And the problem in this implementation was if the glitches appear in the first half cycle of the clock, so that glitch may propagate at the output of this clock gated circuit, which can give rise to switching activity of the subsequent blocks, subsequent computational logic blocks, or sequential, or whatever the circuit is, switching activity will happen over there. So to filter this glitches out, a D flip flop is used along with this AND gate, and the D flip flop will delay the signal, enable signal, before applying to AND gate, and as a result of this implementation, the clock gated output here will not carry any glitch, even if the glitch is present at the input of this clock gated network. Whereas in this second implementation, this is based on an OR gate, and the enable input is inverted here before applying to this OR gate, and clock gated output in this case means the output goes to the high level. When the enable input is zero in this case, then the actual contribution of this to this an OR gate is one, and therefore the output will be always one in this case. So clock gated means a high output level, no switching activity here at the output of the this clock gated circuit, and the output high will be considered as a absence of clock for the subsequent blocks. So this circuit is further modified, further improved again by using this D flip flop. So D flip flop will eliminate the possibility of any glitching, any transition at the output, even if there is a glitch present at the input of this clock gated circuit. So these two implementations are generally used for given hardware clock for the purpose, for the clock gating purpose. So now we'll discuss about the granularity of the clock gating. We'll discuss about what are the levels of the design at which the clock gating can be planned and implemented. So the clock gating can happen at modular level, module level. So this is called module level clock gating, and it could be a register level clock gating, or it could be a cell level clock gating. So the module level clock gating is a very, very useful technique, and it will in this module level clock gating, the big modules of the given hardware are clock gated. For example, let's say that a chip has a transmitter part, receiver part, and a processor part. So at the moment, the chip is, let's say, receiving a signal through the receiver, and there is no transmission happening at the same time. So the transmitter network can be clock gated, so that switching activities can be minimized, unnecessary switching activity can be minimized, and therefore the power can power reduction can also power dissipation can also be minimized in this case. But as you see that the opportunity will be limited, because it will be very, very difficult to switch off very, very difficult to apply clock gating to the bigger blocks so frequently. And also, there could be another problem that if a particular block, when the clock will be supplied, then there will be a larger di by dt. So the current will change rapidly with respect to time, and this could lead to a reliability issue or the performance issue. So here is one example. Here one example is shown of the clock gating, and you can see that a register bank is clock gated with the help of this clock gated network. With the help of this clock gated network, a register bank is clock gated here. And of course, this implementation falls in the category register level clock gating. And modular level clock gating is the higher level of the design abstraction. Register level clock gating is employed at the register level. So in register level clock gating, the clock to a single register or a set of registers is gated. Of course, the power saving will be less than that of the module level, because in module level, the size of the hardware will be bigger than that of a register or a register bank. So when switching activity will be minimized in a bigger module, so power saving will be more in that case. So in register level, the power saving will be less, but compared to the modular level, the scope of cutting the clock will be more. Because the registers can be clock gated very frequently than the whole module of the given chip. So here one example is shown here for register level clock gating. You can see that a register bank is here, and there is a multiplexer. So through the multiplexer, the data in is loaded to the register bank. Okay, so if a new data comes in, the mux is enabled, then the data will be loaded to the register bank. If in a given clock cycle no new data comes in, what will happen? The data that is loaded already to the register bank will keep circulating through this mux, and it will be stored in this register bank in this manner. Whatever the data is, that will come back to the mux, and the mux will again channelize the same data to the register bank. So data keeps on circulating. So you will see that in this case, a lot of switching, unnecessary switching activity will happen, because even if there is no new data, but the switching activity will be happening in this register bank. So that will lead to a lot of unnecessary power dissipation, which can be minimized if a clock gated mechanism is developed. So here you can see that rather than feeding the input to through this multiplexer, here you can see that a clock gated circuit is used. And this clock gated circuit is clock gating this register bank, and then the data in is here, and the enable signal which was used here to enable the multiplexer is now there is an enable signal here, and this enable signal will be generated by a functional unit which will predict that when new data is expected to come to this register bank. And when this enable signal goes high, then when this enable signal will allow, then in that case the new data in will be loaded to this register bank. And when the enable signal doesn't allow, then in that case there will be a clock gated clock will be gated here. There will be no clock, and the switching activity can be stopped. This register bank. this implementation, the use of this clock gating network in this case is definitely going to save a lot of power, because when there is no input signal, when there is no input data for this register bank, in that case the register bank will be electronic activity of the register bank will be stopped by this clock gating network. So this is one of the example of the register level clock gating. Another granularity of the clock gating is the cell level clock gating. So in cell level clock gating, the clock gating circuits are used as a part of a cell. So for example, if there is a memory cell or a register cell, so the cell will be itself designed in such a way that the cell will receive a clock when new data need to be loaded. Okay, unlike this case where the clock gating network is designed externally. See, this clock gating network is designed externally, and with the help of this clock gating network, the data is loaded to this register bank. But in this case, the cell will itself have a clock gating network, and the cell will itself receive a clock when the data need to be loaded. When there is data is not expected to be loaded, then in that case the cell itself will not receive the clock. So the clock gating network is embedded with the cell. So problem with so the design is simple here, because no additional clock gating circuit is required, and also there will not be any issue of the clock skew or the latency. But the main difficulty is if there are a number of cells, so cell design has to include this clock gating part, and the same hardware will be repeated many times in each and every cells, and of course there will be the area overhead. More hardware is to be implemented, so that will be responsible for the large area overhead. So this is the problem with the cell level clock gating. So clock gating has some other issues like clock latency, because this is all about generating global clock and managing clocks, routing them through the interconnects to the different units of the given hardware. So if the clock tree is not designed properly, then the clock latency and clock skew and all these problems will appear. So to take the advantage of the clock gating, these issues need to be taken carefully, so that the switching activity can be minimized and the power can be saved. So clock gating is one of the technique that is used to minimize switching activity, and therefore the dynamic power dissipation can be minimized. So the next technique of minimizing the switching activity is the finite state machine clock gating, FSM clock gating. So I will give you a brief idea about the FSM first, and then we'll discuss how the clock gating in finite state machine can be useful for reducing the switching activity. So I hope that you are familiar with this finite state machine, because this is a very, very important topic of digital system design. And you are aware about the fact that the finite state machines are used to implement the control part of a given hardware, control path of a given digital system or digital hardware. Finite state machine provides organized structure for capturing the control sequences and the operations. So in a finite state machine, is a finite state machine is represented by a state transition diagram. I hope that you are aware about this. One of the state transition diagram is shown here. You can see where you have states. These are the states. So the nodes, labeled nodes, represent the state in state transition diagram. So these are basically states, and the directed edge represents the transition among the states. So these are the states, and these directed edges are representing the transition. So that's why together it's called state transition diagram. So you can see here that there are states S0, S1, S2, S3, S4, S0, S1, S2, S3, S4. S0 is encoded as 000. It is S1 is encoded as 001, 011, 010, and 110. So each states are encoded, and by a and codes are assigned for each states. And then depending upon the input received, whether the output is 0 or 1, and transition happened from one state to another state, accordingly these directed edges are drawn. For example, let's say that if the machine is in the state S3, and then if the input received is x equal to 1, then it goes to the state it goes to the next state S4, whereas when the input received is x equal to 0, then it goes to the state S0. So this is the way a finite state machine, with the help of this state transition diagram, a finite state machine is represented. A general model for a finite state machine is like this. You can see that a finite state machine has a combinational part. This combinational logic will basically be responsible for producing the output and the next state. And there is a D flip flop here, the flip flop or memory, you can say. And this combinational logic accepts the primary inputs PI, X1, X2, XN. And the primary outputs are Z1, Z2, Zm. And the combinational logic also produce the next state. So the next state goes to this D flip-flop network. And the output of this D flip-flop network is basically the present state. So the inputs for this combinational logic is the principal input and the present state. Primary input and the present state, and the output of this combinational logic is primary output and the next state. So this flip flop, this part is basically represented by this different. There will be different states, and based on the states. And based on the given problem, this flip-flop network will be designed. So in general, this FSM is represented by this model. The FSM model essentially includes the primary input, primary output, states, and delta is basically the state transition function, and this lambda is the output transition function. PI is basically set of inputs, that is x1 to xn. PO is set of output, that is z1 to zm. S is the set of states, which are s1, s2 to sp. Delta is the state transition function. This function will determine what will be the next state ns, and essentially the input for this delta are the variable parameters will be s and x, the previous state and the present input. And similarly, the lambda is the output transition function, and this output transition function will determine the next output, and this output will maybe the function of s and x states and present states and the primary input. So this is a general model of a finite state machine, and based on the general models, specific models are also developed. So one of the specific model for the finite state machine is the Miele machine. So in Miele machine, the output PO is basically function of both the present state and the primary input. So the output is a function of present state and the primary input, and also the next state is NS equal to delta of s into x, means the next state is also a function of primary input and the present state. Whereas in Moore machine, you can see that the combinational logic, there are two parts of the combinational logic. So the first part is the combinational logic to compute the output, and the second part is the combinational logic to compute the next state. And here the combinational logic to compute output is only receiving the present state. So the primary output will be determined by the present state only, whereas the next state NS is a function of PS and PI, both present state as well as the inputs are responsible for the next state, whereas only the present state is responsible for the present output. So the machines are classified as a Miele machine or Moore machine, depending upon whether the input, primary input, is being used to compute the primary output or not. So clock gating can be utilized in this finite state machine. And you might be knowing that there is a possibility that there will not be change in the state for some time or for some input combination, because you can see that even if you can see in this example, then this state is S0 when the input received is x equal to 0. Then it still remains in the same state. It is not changing. So no dynamic activity, no switching activity is happening. So in a bigger machine, there is a more probability that the switching activity will not happen and the FSM will be in the idle state. So to minimize the switching activity in those situations, the clock, the latch will now can receive the gated clock. So the function FCJ will be designed in such a way that it will predict the condition that when this latch will not be subject to the electronic activity, and based on this, based on the prediction of this FCJ, a clock gated, the clock will be gated here, and the gated clock will stop the switching activity in this latch, and therefore switching activity can thus can be minimized. Okay, so clock of so the FSM can be also clock gated in order to minimize the switching activity and the power dissipation. So here is one of the example how the clock gated is being used. in a finite state machine. So here is a, you can see a finite state machine, and the finite state machine is start by will be start by this start this signal. So when the signal is signal is going to turn this state machine on, and this finite state machine is communicating with a timer counter through these two signals. So one is timer counter enable. So this FSM will send a signal timer counter enable, that will enable this timer counter. And then there is another communication line here. Other signal that is being transmitted, being sent by this FSM, is timer counter set. So this this signal timer counter will set this timer counter to for an appropriate count. Timer counter is of course run by a clock, and then this timer counter will release a signal here based on. Based on the target that was set. Let's say that this FSM has set a some target for this timer counter to run for a given time period. So once the time period is over, once the counting is done by this timer counter, then this timer counter will release a signal to FSM, and FSM will know that the required time is completed, and then this FSM can utilize that time. So for example, let's say that this FSM can this finite state machine would like to be in the idle state for 10 seconds. So what it will do, it will set a it will release a timer counter enable signal, which will enable this timer counter. And once the timer counter is enabled, then this signal TC set will set this timer counter for to run for 10 seconds. So this 10 second, and then after running, after counting, after running for the 10 seconds, this timer counter will send a signal to FSM that yes, now the this counting is over, and then this FSM can be activated, because this FSM is utilizing this timer counter to be in the idle period for the 10 seconds. So after 10 seconds, the timer counter will release a signal, and this FSM becomes active, and it's participating the electronic activity. So based on this two signal, you can see that timer counter enable and the timer counter set, considering these two signals as input, this functional unit will can generate a functional clock. And once it will this functional unit will generate an enable signal, and this enable signal will produce a clock, a gated clock here, and that gated clock will turn this FSM off for the 10 seconds. Okay, so this is how the functions this function is designed. It can utilize some conditions, and those conditions can be utilized to design a function and to generate the enable signal. And the enable signal will basically here will generate a gated clock for 10 seconds, during which this FSM wants to be in idle condition, and lot of switching activity can be minimized here. And not here, but this FSM is going to drive some other sequential or combinational circuit. Even the switching activity can also be minimized in the those stages, and therefore you can see that a lot of switching activity is minimized as a whole, and therefore the power dissipation can also be minimized. So this is how this clock gating can be utilized in a finite state machine. Then we'll discuss the topic finite state machine encoding, because encoding by proper encoding, a finite state machine we can also minimize a lot of switching activity, and therefore the dynamic power dissipation can be minimized. So the state assignment is an important step in the synthesis of a finite state machine. There will be number of states, so each states will be given a suitable port. Those codes are basically the unique codes. Those are the unique code. The unique code will explain or will refer to those unique states. And the state assignment influences the complexity of the combinational logic part. Traditionally, the state assignment has been used to save area and the delay of the circuit. This can also be used to reduce the switching activity. So traditionally the state encoding is used to reduce the is used to save the area and the delay of a given circuit, but it can also be used to reduce the switching activity. How it can be used, that becomes clear in the next slide. Okay, let's say that a problem is but before discussing that problem, let us say that let us talk about the objective function of a state machine. The objective function will basically quantify, you can say, the transition activity in a given finite state machine. So the objective function gamma is defined as sigma Pij into Wij, where Pij is the probability of transition from state Si to Sj. Let's say that after Si, the machine is going to Sj state. So what is the probability that machine is going from Si to Sj state, one state to next state? And Wij is the corresponding weight representing the activity factor. So activity factor will be represented by Wij, and Pij is the probability that a machine is going from one state to next state. Here one example is shown. This example, this state transition diagram is of a finite state machine, which is going to detect five ones as subsequent one. Okay. So this machine is designed to detect that there are five subsequent ones received. Okay. So you can see that there are five states defined here: S1, S2, S3, S4, S5. Let's say that the initially the machine is in this S1 state, and when the input is the input received is 0, then the output will be 0, and the machine is again in the S1 state. So since when the one input is received, which is 0, the machine objective to detect the five sequential one is not satisfied, therefore the machine output will be 0. So we represent it by 0 by 0. 0 received and the 0 output, and no change in the state. So state remains S1. But when let's say that first one received one, then the machine enters to the next state S2 with still the 0 output, because the objective is to detect five sequential one. And when the machine is in S2 state, then if again the 0 is received, 0 is the input, then it goes back to the S1 state to initialize the machine. However, if another one is received, then it goes to another state S3 with the output still 0. Then if the machine is in S3, then if the input is received input at 0, it will go back to the S1 state with the 0 output. Whereas if it receives one, then it goes to the S4 state. So from S4 state again, if the input is 0, it goes to S10 initial state, or with 1, it goes to the S5 state. So till now, there are 5 subsequents, 1 detected, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Then if the machine is in S5 state, then even if the 0 received, it will go to the initial state with the 0 output. But if the 1 is received, it will go back to the initial state with 1 as the output. The output 1 means the 5 ones have been detected by this sequence detector machine. Okay. So for this machine, the assignment of the code assignment for the different states is an important task, and the codes will be assigned in such a way that that will lead to the lesser switching activity in the machine. So here basically you can see the next slide, there are two schemes that are used to assign. There are two different assignment for the states. In assignment 1, you can see that the state S1 is represented by 000, S2 is represented by 111, then this is 001, S3, S4 is 110, S5 is represented by 101. So these sequences are random, and if the objection function is computed, then this this is okay. The slide is turned up.
Yes, sir.
Is it visible now?
No, sir.
I have to restart. So you'll have to join again. Can you hear me? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay. We were just discussing about the assignments of the courts for the different states, and there are two schemes here. In first assignment scheme, the courts are given for S1000, S2111 to S5101. There is another assignment here where the codes are 00, 001, 010, 011, 010, 100. So the objective functions are different. For the first assignment, it is 10, whereas for the second assignment, it is 5.5. So the second assignment is, of course, a good one that will basically reduce the switching activity. And how the objective functions are computed, that is shown here in the next slide, you can see. So since there are five states, S1, S2 to S5, and the diagram and the state transition diagram here is, you can see S1 transition is happening from S1 to S1, S1 to S2, S2 to S1. And similarly, S2 to S3, S3 to S1, similarly, S5 to always S1, whether the input is 0 or input is 1. So there are 9 combinations here, S1 to S1, S1 to S2, S2 to S1, S2 to S3, S3 to S1, to S5 to S1. So in first assignment, you can see that the code which is given for S1 is 000. And if the input received is 0, that means for S1 to S1 transition, for input to 0, output to 0. So for S1 to S1 transition, the probability that the machine will be in this S1 state is 0.5. And the total number of transitions that are happening in the code are actually 0, because it was initially 000 and now it is 000. So that is 0. So 0 multiplied by 0.5 is 0. So here the probability is 0.5 based on the fact that there is a equal probability of occurrence of 0 or 1 as a input. So for S1 to S2 transition, however, you can see from S1 to S2 transition, the probability that it will go from S1 to S2 is 0.5 again, because the probability of occurrence of 1 as a input is 0.5. So 0.5 multiplied by the 3 transition, because earlier it was 000, now it has been 111. So all 3 bits are changing from 0 to 1. So the occurrence here is 3, so it goes to 1.5. Okay. Similarly, you can see that from S4 to S1, here from S4 to S1, from S4 to S1, the probability of a transition is 0.5, and when it is changing from S4 to S1, you see that the 2 bits are changing. This LSB remains as it is. Next bit is changing from 1 to 0, and the most significant bit is also changing from 1 to 0. So 2 transition multiplied by 0.5 means here we get 1. And this is the way by which you can calculate by which you can calculate this objective function. And the only notable thing here in this case is when it is transition is happening from S5 to S1. So from S5 to S1 transition, you can see whether the input received is 0 or input received is 1. Both cases, you can see that the machine is going from S5 state to S1 state. So the probability of transition from S5 to S1 is always 1, and the transition is basically from S5, in S5 state the code is 10101, and in S1 state the code is 000. So there are 2 bit transition here, so it's multiplied by 2, so we get 10 here. Now so we get here 2. So the total weight is the sum of these 3 individual components. You can see that the objective function is defined as sum of pij wij. So the objective functions here is calculated for case 1 is 10, and in the same manner it can also be computed for assignment 2. So for example, from S5 to S1 transition, so from S5 to S1 transition the transition probability is 1, and this is basically 1 because you can see that in the assignment 2 the S5 is noted as 100 and the S0 is 000, so there is change in only 1 bit. So 1 multiplied by 1 is 1. So the total weight here is only 5.5, here it is 10. It means that this encoding scheme is much better than the first one in terms of minimizing switching activity and power dissipation. So encoding of states is an important activity which can be useful for saving minimizing the dynamic power dissipation. Okay. So then here another technique, which is FSM partitioning. So FSM partitioning is done in large finite state machines. So you can see that here a finite state machine is shown, and this is the main branch. States are S21, S22, S23. Between S22 to S23, you can see between S22 to S23. There is a subroutine here which is running, and the subroutine is also a FSM, which is has the states T0, T1, T2, T3. So what could be done, that it's very obvious that this subroutine will not always be working to perform activity. So what could be done, that this finite state machine can be partitioned like this. So here we have the main branch S21, S22, then the two additional transition, two additional states are introduced, one in this main branch and another one is in subroutine, and these two are just to establish the interface between the subroutine and the main branch. So main branch computation will be carried out, and when it will be required, then only this subroutine will run and provide the information to this main branch. So when not necessary, then this subroutine, now the partition subroutine, can be clock gated, so that unnecessary electronic activity in this finite state machine, in this subroutine, will not happen, and the power saving can be ensured in this case. So bigger finite state machine, so of course the overhead is now the larger silicon area, so we have to make a trade off between the silicon area, hardware, and the power dissipation. So finite state machine partitioning is done for larger machines in order to ensure the lower dynamic power dissipation. So very quickly I will go through this another technique of operand isolation, which seems to be very simple but very effective. Okay, so just go to this, let us go to this example and see what is happening here. So we have one adder here, ALU unit, which is performing addition operation. So A and B are getting added, So after addition, we have get some output, and then this output is output of this adder is to be loaded to a register, or it's loaded to a flip flop here. And this loading is done not always, but it is being done in a certain condition. The certain condition is this S1 must be 1 and this S2 must be 0. If S1 is 1, then only this output will be allowed to pass through it. And when S2 is 0, then only this output is allowed to pass through this flip flop. So the addition is happening here always, but in each and every clock cycle, the addition is being performed. And the sum is, however, not loaded to the flip flop until this condition S1 and S2, S1 is 1 and S2 is 0 is reached. Okay, so what happens? Lot of undesirable activity will be happening here. Let's say that the probability of occurrence of this S1 and S2 to 1 and 0 respectively is very, very less. So in that case, whatever computation is happening here, that is useless, that is actually not being utilized, that is not being stored to this D flip flop. So this is a kind of wastage of power. This activity should be properly managed so that switching activity can be minimized and power dynamic power reduction can be also minimized. So rather than implementing this functionality in this fashion, this can be implemented in the following fashion. You can see now the input S1 and S2 can be used to generate a control signal. Okay, so S1 is taken directly to an AND gate here, and the invert of S2 is taken to this AND gate. And this signal is basically the output of this is ANDed to the input A and B. So if the output here AS is 1, then only the input A and B are allowed to appear at the input lines of this adder. And then only the computation will happen, and out at the same time you can see that when this AS will be 1, the AS will be 1 when the S1 is 1 and S2 is 0. If S2 is 0, then here we'll have 1 1 1, so output 1, and this one will facilitate, this one will enable this A and B to appear at the input of this adder, and then addition will be performed here. And at the same time, because S1 is 1 and S2 is 0, then this condition is also meet here, and the two muxes here will allow this signal to be loaded to this D flip flop. If S1 and S2 is not 0, sorry, if S1 and S2 is not 1 and 0 respectively, then in that case, the output will always be 0 here, and this 0 output is this 0 output will disable this 2 AND gate, and therefore the adder here will not perform the addition operation, and therefore the switching activity can be minimized. So this technique is called the operand isolation. So this operand can be isolated properly here, because the two operands A and B are isolated from this adder with the help of this additional hardware in this case. Okay, so we'll stop here today. We'll continue this in the next class, because we have lost some time during the lecture because of the technical glitch. Okay, we'll continue this in the next class. We'll be talking about the other switching activity minimization technique. Meanwhile, if you have some question, you can ask.
Sir,
yes.
We directly feed the adder out to the D flip flop, then sir, there may be the less hardware complexity.
No, so adder, the demand of the design is that adder output is not always to be loaded to this flip flop. Basically, this hardware is a part of a bigger problem. Okay, so problem objective is let's say like this, that the output here will be loaded to the flip flop or register only when this S1 is 1 and S2 is 0. So if not so, then it should not be loaded. Okay, so we cannot directly connect this output of this adder to this D flip flop. Okay, oh, you are talking about this case when this is implemented, S1 and S2, this additional hardware is implemented.
Yes, sir.
So when this additional hardware is implemented, then you can say that yes, it's true. Then even in the absence of these two, basically it is going to work. Okay.
And sir, in objective function, how sir encoding is it PG field?
Pardon?
Sir, in this objective function. Sir, how the encoding one is performed? That is, sir, is it random or sir, it is predefined?
Some algorithm can always be developed, okay, to get the best encode. But I think depending upon the transition happening, I think it will change. And a changed encoding scheme will we need to change this according to the transition happening. Let's say that there are five states here, but if I change the problem, if the transition will start happening in a different fashion, then a different coding scheme can provide us the better result. So maybe some sort of algorithm can be developed so that that can be used to assign the code. Okay, so the things we have to ensure that the coding the codes will be assigned in such a way that for the given problem it will assign it will be responsible for the laser switching activity. Okay, so if there is any algorithm, then you can go through the technical literature, you try to search some papers. Okay, maybe you will find some algorithm through which you can be automatically you can be able to generate the codes for a given finite state machine. It's always possible to write a algorithm for this. Okay. Anybody? Any other question? So, what is the overall feedback? Is it okay? Are you comfortable with this? Any specific issue? Any problem? Then you can also discuss that with me. I should call someone. Okay, Sahil, can you hear me? So any specific issue, problem if you are facing, then please let me know.
Sir, if you discuss the numericals based on these topics, then it would be much better.
Numericals. So first we have to discuss the techniques, then only after that we can go to the numerical. Okay, so definitely we'll take some examples later on to elaborate these topics. Okay, but this is mainly this is actually theoretical part of your course, so not too much numerical is there. These are only methods that are used at the different levels of design abstraction to minimize the switching activity. Okay, there is a very limited scope for the numerical in this section.
Problem. When you the screen page on your screen, then it takes on our screen.
Okay, that's good. I will discuss this with the CC team. Okay, how to resolve this? I have also noticed this. Okay, In recorded video, I have saw that there is a synchronization issue.
There is a host problem. But I don't know how somehow the charge of the video get transferred to someone else. It happened automatically, or there is some bug or something. We don't know.
Pardon, I'm not getting actually, because your voice is not coming properly. Can you ask your question once again?
The presenter and the host of the meeting automatically gets changed. We don't know why this is happening. There may be some bug or something. This is what happened in the video after 40 minutes. Sir, your control over the PPT go transfer to someone else.
Oh, it. Okay. So I will discuss.
It became the host of the video.
Okay, I will discuss this issue with the technical team. Okay, so let us stop here today. You might have some another class. We'll discuss, we'll continue this next class too.